Welcome to Digging Deeper with Backyard Farmer. I'm your host, Kim Todd. On Digging Deeper, we have in-depth discussions with our extension experts about important landscape topics. Tonight, we're going to be discussing rain gardens in the home landscape. Thank you for joining us once again for Digging Deeper with Backyard Farmer. You know, rain gardens are much more than just a fad. They can help you conserve that precious runoff water around your home. On top of that, they can add so much color and beauty to your landscape. So joining me tonight is longtime Backyard Farmer panelist, Kelly Feehan.
Hi, Kim.
Kelly, glad you could come from Columbus.
That's
and
right.
Of course, you're on the show anyway, and that makes it great.
That worked out well.
You are really kind of, you're recognized as one of the rain garden experts in extension. So let's start by telling our audience, what is a rain garden and what isn't it?
Okay, well, you kind of started the description when you started. I mean, it's a garden for aesthetics and for beauty, but it has that added purpose of collecting and holding rainwater for a short period of time. And the purpose for doing that, you know, as Kim said, is to make the most of that rainfall when we get it. Instead of directing it off of our property as quickly as possible, let's use that precious natural resource, which a lot of us are hoping for right now because we need it. So let's capture some of it and rather than letting it run off. And the other main reason that they became so popular to begin with is to reduce that water runoff, which can carry some pollutants to our surface water like rivers, lakes, and streams. And what it isn't is it's not a pond, it's not a wetland or a water garden. So if it's correctly sited and you correctly install it and design it, it will only hold rainwater for about 24 to 48 hours at the most. So we prefer that they drain completely in about 24 hours, but after some heavy rains, it might be up to 48 hours. So a lot of people view them as mosquito breeding holes, but because they're designed the way they are designed, that water's gone in 48 hours, and that's too short of a period for mosquitoes to breed.
So given that they're not a pond, they're not a swale, mm-hmm. they're not a creek, they're not a river, where in the home landscape is the best spot to locate them, and how do you figure that out?
Okay, well, you want to locate them where water will run into them. So typically in a home landscape, they're fairly close to where a downspout is, but they can be located where water can come upslope from a lawn, from a driveway, or even from a patio area, an impervious surface of some sort. Just traditionally, and it's easiest sometimes to design them where water can be directed into them from a downspout. They need to be at least 10 feet away from the house because we don't want that water that's collected to end up in the basement. So that's kind of a general rule of thumb. A few other, the soil must be well drained. We say that of all plants. I mean, that's true of all plants, but it's especially true for a rain garden to assist with that water draining away in that 24 to 48 hours. So the soil needs to be well drained. A few other considerations is, if you're in a rural area, they need to be 25 feet from a well. Or even if you happen to have one in town, which most people don't, but 25 feet from a septic drain field. Call Digger's Hotline. Know where your underground lines are. They don't want to be, some people will say to me, I have a perfect spot for a rain garden. After a rain, it always flows to this one spot and it just sits there. And that's might be the worst place to put a rain garden because if it is sitting there and it's not draining, maybe too much water is draining to it, or the soil's just compacted in that area and it won't drain away. That doesn't mean you can't use a site like that with some improvement to the soil, but don't assume that that's the best place to put it. There's other things, gentle slope. You don't want to put them on a really, really steep slope. They can be put there, but it takes a lot more planning and design and a lot more work to install them. So usually we say 12% or less slope. Don't put them underneath the tree. Because if you have full sun, you can select more plants. And number one, you have to dig. So we don't want to damage the roots of those trees. So those are some key things. I might have missed one or two, but those are some key things. We do have NEB guides at extensionpubs.unl.edu with a NEB guide on designing rain gardens and an extension circular that goes in depth on where to site them and where to design them and install them.
You know, Kelly, I think people think of it as mm-hmm. being sloped.
Right.
So technically, the bottom is not sloped, and there's a little bit of a lip, right?
Right. The key, probably the key features of a rain garden that make it unique from other rain gardens is that it is a shallow bowl, but the bowl, the bottom of the bowl is flat. And the reason for that is we want that water to disperse evenly across the bottom and not pool on one end or the other, because we want it to infiltrate into that soil evenly and be gone in 24 to 48 hours throughout the whole garden. So that's a critical thing, is that bottom is flat. They're anywhere from, they're typically about 8 inches deep. Some are a little deeper if you're in a sandy loam soil and you're collecting from a large surface area of rainwater. Some of them can be as shallow as 4 inches. But that bottom has to be deep. There's usually gently sloping sides. And then there's berms. Typically, there's short berms, probably on three sides, ideally. Other characteristics is an inlet. You need a location in that garden where the water is going to flow in to the garden. Typically, it's from a downspout with an extension on it, because you have to be 10 feet from the house. Sometimes some people will use like a shallow swale, and it can have grass in it. Some people like to put landscape fabric with rocks and make it look like a stream, and even though there's no water in it, except when it rains. So you have to have an overflow with a rain garden. That's another thing that's different from a regular garden. What we mean by that is in the berm itself, opposite the inlet, there's usually an area that cut out maybe a couple of inches deeper than the rest of the berm with some soil armor. Again, landscape fabric and some rocks is typically used. But in those years that we do get those 4-inch, 6-inch, 7-inch rains, which have happened in past years, you want that excess water to be able to drain out, overflow, and drain out into the lawn area or someplace like that. So those are some probably distinct differences that make them different than a regular rain garden or a regular garden.
Excellent. So the fun part about digging deeper, of course, is our Facebook followers get to weigh in, decide, tell us what they like, what they don't like. We actually are airing Digging Deeper right after Backyard Farmer this season. So it's that Thursday nights, just get that popcorn and settle in and talk to us on Facebook and tell us what you like about this. And I'm certain we'll get a lot of comments about the rain gardens, Kelly.
Good.
So, you know, a lot of people are aware of what we call the rain chain on East Campus, which is in our Backyard Farmer garden.
Right.
And if they think about what you just told them and they look at ours, they're going to think we don't know what we're doing.
That's right.
But ours is deeper on purpose, and each one is technically its own little rain garden with an inlet, an outlet, a berm, flat with just enough slope. So, and the reason we did that, of course, is to demonstrate to people this is what you could do on a smaller scale.
Right. And I believe the Backyard Farmer Garden is taking rainwater from the street.
It is.
So it's a larger, probably a larger volume of rainwater flowing into it. So, yeah, when I described it, I described a typical rain garden for a residential landscape, and one that most homeowners could design and install themselves. But sometimes the sky's the limit in a way if you're creative enough.
Right. So. Is there a tiniest size, and is there a size where it gets so big that then it really is something different?
Right. For home landscapes, they range in size from about 100 square feet to 300 square feet. They recommend you don't go over 300 square feet because that can get a little overwhelming and a little bit more difficult to design and install. But to decide on the size, like a regular garden, you know, what can you maintain? What can you handle? But with a rain garden, there's that extra step. You need to estimate the surface area that's going to be draining water into that garden. So let's just assume it's from a downspout. So you need to estimate, you know, the square footage of the portion of the roof that might be draining to that downspout. And that's that extension circular I talked about has like a design worksheet where you can input that information and it'll calculate it for you. Mm-hmm. So I would encourage you, if you decide to do one on your own, to go to that EC and use that design worksheet. But you need to know the surface area that's going to be draining rainwater to that site. You need to know your soil type, and that'll help you determine the square footage you should have, as well as the depth. So if it's in a sandy loam soil, they can be a little bit deeper because it'll drain a little faster. Remind me to talk about a soil percolation test because that's really important. Yeah. But in a soil, you know, sometimes, you know, not everybody has a sandy loam soil. So if you want to use one and you do have a heavier clay soil, maybe a shallower rain garden would be used with a bigger overflow and just some time for those roots to dig deeper and right. channel and improve that drainage before some people will then add to the berm and make it deeper over time once that soil starts to drain a little bit better.
Right, so I was going to actually ask mm-hmm. you about a perk test. What okay. what is that? Because we did do that, of course. We okay. had to right. In our gardens.
Yeah. I think everybody should do a percolation test, yeah. whether it's a rain garden or not, because well-drained soils are so important to our plants. But I will say you must do a soil percolation test if you're going to install a rain garden. And what that is just digging a hole. If it's a small garden, you could do one. If it's going to be a fairly large garden, you might want to do that in at least two locations in the garden, maybe three. But basically, you dig a hole 6 inches by 6 inches, 8 inches by 8 inches. You fill that up with water, and then you watch. You put a yardstick in there. Ideally, you might put another ruler kind of stuck horizontally, and you fill the water up to the top of that, put in your yardstick. And you would check it about every hour if you could. At a minimum, it should drain about a fourth of an inch an hour, and that's the minimum. It would be better if it drained a little faster. If you can't keep checking it every hour, then you know at least that rate water should be gone in about 24 hours, ideally. Don't do a soil percolation test in the middle of July and August when we haven't had any rain, or this year right now, because you might have cracks and crevices in that dry soil that can be deceiving on how fast that water drains when it is wet. So if you have to do a soil percolation test at that time, make sure you know maybe fill it twice.
Mm-hmm. So it's, or water the surrounding mm-hmm. area.
Oh yeah, right.
And then get
irrigate
it a little,
first.
The profile.
And yeah. So that's yeah. that. Yeah, it's not real. It's not real right. scientific. But it's a great thing to do. And even if you're not sure what type of soil you have, you know, you can do the ribbon test.
Right.
As well, and that's just getting maybe a cup of soil and adding a little bit of water and, you know, squeezing it. If it's smooth, if it's sticky, then it's. And if you can ribbon it out to about an inch and a half. Then it's probably a clay soil, and either you don't want to put your rain garden there, or you're going to have to be doing some additional soil work and incorporation of compost and so on to help it to drain better.
Excellent. So we have dug deeper on this one, Kelly. We'll save our plant discussion, which of course is what most gardeners really want to hear. Mm-hmm. We'll save that for another time, because that is all the time we do have for Digging Deeper with Backyard Farmer. Thanks to Kelly for coming by to help us with this very important topic, sharpen those spades. We will be back next week with another discussion about gardening topics that matter to you. Do be sure to watch Backyard Farmer Live every Thursday, 7 p.m. Central on NET. Thanks for digging deeper with Backyard Farmer. Mm-hmm.